Father, thank you for this day, and again, thank you for such a beautiful day. Father, we just thank you for this time. Lord, we just pray that you pray that, Father, that you'd be the pastor as he leads us. And Father, as we listen and obey, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Yeah, I have to admit, when Paul said the song was called O Buddha, there was definitely a little concern in my mind. It was definitely better than I thought, so that was good. Next time we'll have to get Neil to get a little closer to the microphone. No? Stephan? That was a straight face. I think I just was told not to do that at all. This morning I actually have two sermons for you guys, so you guys are lucky. I actually was up a little bit last night just thinking about the developments in our country, and I think it's important for our church to be the prophetic voice to our community and to our nation. And so I don't think a decision like Friday's could go without at least some mention. There'll be spots where it's appropriate in our sermon as well to talk about it, but there's also some mention about how we as Christians should react to a decision like that by the Supreme Court. The first thing that we all can loudly say is that Jesus is still on the throne. That marriage was not redefined from a Christian perspective. Marriage has never once been defined by how the Supreme Court, the local government, or anyone else has defined it. That's their institution, is how they've borrowed it from ours, and maybe how the church has even kind of relinquished some of the control of marriage. I think that may have been where the downfall happened, was when the church first gave the authority of marriage to the government. It kind of let them now claim that. But our definition of marriage has not changed. Our Bible hasn't changed. Jesus hasn't changed. He's still the same that he was on Thursday, that he was on Friday. So we serve a Lord who doesn't change and that can respond to situations like this with, honestly, with love and with mercy. It's not a loving thing to lead people to endorse or to institutionalize or to legalize an unrepentant, sinful lifestyle. That is not a loving thing. And we'll talk about that a little bit this morning as well. So we have to understand, first of all, that our biblical marriage was not redefined. We have been and are now even more visible now in our community because we do stand opposed to what the government has decided to, I guess, legalize on a grander scale. And this kind of brings me, when I was thinking about different verses and things that could really speak to the situation, the first one is from 1 Peter 2, just a couple verses beginning in 9. And I love this. This is really a charge for us. It says in 1 Peter 2, verse 9, "But you are a chosen race," speaking, of course, to the church, to Christians, to believers. "You are a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people for his own possession, that you may proclaim the excellencies of him who called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. Once you were not a people, but now you are God's people. Once you had not received mercy, but now you have received mercy." So that is our calling. We are even more visible now, today, than we were maybe even before Thursday. It's a day that will stand much like Roe versus Wade. The situations are completely different. What's at stake is completely different, but both of them call against the true biblical paths of what God has called us for in terms of how we live and conduct with our lives. And we must remember that our battleground is never anything but the gospel. And the gospel then can inform all of these other areas in our lives. How we value life from all facets, from conception all the way through the end of life. How we define marriage, because that is a God-ordained institution. We aren't borrowing that from secularization. That is God's doing, get what God has ordained. So we don't borrow and ask that. So that gospel that is our battleground is where we fight. Now we certainly have little battles that we do fight, and little battles that are really big in society, that we do fight for sanctity of life. And much ground has been made, praise God for that, for hopefully for his glory and the saving of lives. But now we're going to be called into a more visible role where we are standing opposed to what is made to be out the majority. So have us understand, the Bible has us understand especially, that our battle hasn't changed. We've always been fighting for the gospel, and the gospel will always be under attack. We shouldn't be surprised. But as our text that we'll get into this morning reminds us, we're standing now in the light that is already shining from 1 John that we'll look at. So there's a lot of truth and comfort that can come from that. Government-defined marriage took a hit, but the gospel did not. and we should not react with bitterness, hate, and ungodly words or conduct. We have amazing forgiveness to offer to all. Let forgiveness and mercy drive our conduct. Let's not look to win arguments or to win the best put down, so that if we were on some news talk show, somebody would go, wow, that was great and poignant. No, let's win for the gospel. Because many people are going to be led astray now. Their sinful lifestyle has just been endorsed, which makes them feel even more empowered. And that's the last thing we want. We want them to live in a close, loving, repentant lifestyle with their Lord and Savior. That's where our battleground is. And finally, our sovereign Lord was not surprised by the Supreme Court. He wasn't. He knew it was coming. He was not surprised by the president, by the cabinet, by legislatures, by the press following Friday's decision, or even by society's reaction. I'm on Twitter, and I was amazed at how many pastors had actually, I guess you can promote your own tweet, how many pastors had actually promoted their tweet where they were out in support rallies for the decision of the Supreme Court. So we are living in a time where it's unparalleled in regards to where the assaults are coming on the gospel, and we should live in light. The other verses that I wanted to talk about, and it's Romans 1, and I thought the timing was interesting. I'd actually, if Terry was here, she could vouch for this. I sent her my newsletter prior to these discussions, prior to this Supreme Court's decision. So our newsletter is a little bit timely, but there's a couple of verses I want to read from Romans 1. The first one is verses 28 through 32, and Paul begins, "And since they did not see fit to acknowledge God, God gave them up to a debased mind to do what ought not to be done. They were filled with all manner of unrighteousness, evil, covetousness, malice. They're full of envy, murder, strife, deceit, maliciousness. They're gossips, slanderers, haters of God, insolent, haughty, boastful, inventors of evil, disobedient to parents, foolish, faithless, heartless, ruthless." Verse 32, "Though they know God's righteous decree that those who practice such things deserve to die, they not only do them, but they give approval to those who practice them." And that's really what happened today, or on Friday anyways. Approval was given for a sinful lifestyle, and for that we should mourn and really seek to be more of the light into our community. But I love the fact that before Paul ever gets to 28 through 32, he actually tells us some great good news in Romans 1. Prior to this, he says in verse 16, "For I am not ashamed of the gospel, for it is the power of God for salvation to everyone who believes, to the Jew first and also to the Greek. For in it, in the gospel, the righteousness of God is revealed from faith for faith, as it is written, the righteous shall live by faith." So we can and should be rightly and righteously indignant and upset with the decision that was made. But the gospel is still powerful to change lives. The gospel didn't take a hit. And we as the church, I think we need to be ready for an onslaught of refugees that are going to be hurt by these decisions. People that are being told that your happiness is now legal, and then they have that emptiness still because they don't have Christ's forgiveness, because they stand guilty before the Lord like we once did. We as a church need to be ready to be lovingly bringing those people into our fold and giving them the good news of the saving faith in Jesus Christ. The forgiveness that's offered by them, the mercy. Not endorsing a sinful lifestyle, but love and mercy in a changed life. So, before we begin our second sermon this morning, I thought we could spend some time in prayer. Prayer for not only for our government and the decisions they make, but prayer for our society. Prayer for hearts to not believe the lie that everything that the government says is the good thing and the right thing to do. That we get our truth and we get our understanding of life through the Word of God. So let's pray this morning. And we'll spend some time, I'll start it with just some silent prayer, and then I'll close with a prayer. So we'll spend some time in silent prayer. Father, as we think about our own lives, we think to that time when we walked in rebellion to you, Lord. We think about the lies that we believed about our sin, that our sin would bring us happiness. We even looked at the fact that maybe our sin was legal, and that maybe gave us justification for believing the lie of the devil that says that our sin is going to provide us happiness. And Father, the realization came that we actually stood condemned before you, and that you're far less concerned with our temporary happiness than you are with our eternal joy. Lord, I ask that you just provide a special mercy this morning to people that are believing that lie. I ask that you continue to help us to be strong as witnesses for you, Lord, and to remember that our true cause is the gospel, that may go forth because there's healing involved in the gospel. There's change involved in the gospel. There's not a person here this morning, Lord, that stands before you as a child of God that doesn't have change in their life. Lord, help that to be our message this morning. Father, be with our government and with our officials that rule over us, Lord, and help them to see the error in their ways. And if they don't, Lord, we just pray that our churches would remain strong, not shake in the face of opposition. That we stand firm because in the covenant of marriage, Lord, you're picturing the marriage of Jesus Christ in the church, and that's not something we trifle with or something we take lightly. It's something we protect, Lord, because you ordained it. Father, provide healing. Help us to be ready to welcome in the refugees of this worldview that's going to create much heartbreak and hurt in our society. Help us to continue to be strong for the gospel, for your glory, and that Jesus' name can grow loudly and proudly and truly from churches to believers and out to the world. It's in Jesus' matchless name we pray. Amen. Well, we're going to come to the week 4 of our series through 1 John. And I thought we would begin with a little bit of a recap. So I don't know if the slideshow is ready. We can bring the first slide up, the next slide. So where have we been? We saw the first week in 1 John verses 1 through 4 that fullness of joy is offered. And what a great promise that is, that we can have fullness of joy. And then that fullness of joy was explained really with the right understanding of who Jesus is. That when we understand Jesus rightly and correctly, we have the right Jesus, that then we can have fellowship with God and fellow believers. And that is part of our joy being made complete. Following that, that fellowship was explained with that great three-word statement that God is light. And relevant for us this morning, that moral implications, the ethical implications that come with that, and that he is true, and that he is holy, and that he alone is worthy of glory and honor. And I love the fact that that is actually what motivates and empowers our fellowship. Next slide, please. And then last week we looked at the fact that Jesus Christ is our righteous advocate. That in 1 John 2, those first two verses, 1 and 2, that is some of the most theologically condensed, rich narrative of who Christ is and what he's done for us. That in that, he's given us a loving command that we shouldn't sin. And that the command to not sin is truly loving, because God isn't keeping us from something better. He's not like saying, look at that beautiful flowery pasture over there and then keeping you in something surrounded by thorns and thistles. No, he's saying, keeping you where the flowers are and keeping you away from the thorns and thistles when he says, do not sin. So he's keeping us from something that hurts us and that harms us, but keeping us for himself and for his glory. And we also saw that big word that, again, I'm sure you guys have worked into your everyday language, propitiation, but that Jesus is the satisfaction of the wrath of God that is justly due on you and me, that we stood as right recipients of God's just wrath because of our own sin. That, yes, we have Adamic sin, that when Adam fell, all of humankind fell, but then now we've also earned for ourselves our own unright, our own wrath of God. And that in propitiation, in that big word, that the wrath of God was satisfied. I think we talked about the fact that Jesus didn't deflect God's wrath. He didn't put his hand over the hose and stop it. He didn't use a trash can lid to block the flow of it. That he absorbed it, that it was spent on him. God's wrath that was for you, that you had justly earned, has been spent on Jesus. Let that power our Good Friday and Easter celebrations, and then every Sunday, and well, why not every day of the week as well? But that his wrath was spent. It's not waiting out there and holding in a holding pattern. So that waiting for you to mess up, waiting for you to sin, that's not what is happening. What's happening is the wrath was spent on Jesus, and then now we have forgiveness. We have the forgiveness of Jesus, the ability to go to God and to confess our sins. He's faithful and just to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. So it's a beautiful proposition where I really think, you know, you really can't get a better deal than that. We surrender our life to Christ, he absorbs God's wrath, and he also empowers us to live a sinless life, but we do still sin, and then he offers forgiveness for that too. And then the third point we saw last week was that God's love is perfected in us when we walk in him. And that really comes from a right understanding of what sin is. That when we walk in him, we are experiencing God's love. We're experiencing the most tangible aspect of God's love for us. And so that brings us to our slide, or I guess to our text this morning. I'm so used to saying slide. I know you guys just stood for Tom's reading from John 3, but if you would please, if you're able, please stand as we read from John 1, or 1 John, sorry. 1 John chapter 2, verses 7 through 11. I love that he begins with more loving language. Last week it was little children. And then this morning he begins in 1 John 2, verse 7, Beloved. Beloved, I'm writing you no new commandment, but an old commandment that you had from the beginning. The old commandment is the word that you have heard. At the same time, it is a new commandment that I am writing to you, which is true in him and in you, because the darkness is passing away and the true light is already shining. Whoever says he is in the light and hates his brother is still in darkness. Verse 10, whoever loves his brother abides in the light, and in him there is no cause for stumbling. But whoever hates his brother is in the darkness and walks in the darkness and does not know where he is going because the darkness has blinded his eyes. Let's pray. Father God, help us to be believers who seek to walk in the light, and as you put it here, Lord, to abide in the light, to be active in our walk, Lord, and again, not to earn salvation. That's not the point of this text, Father, but to walk in obedience and to walk in conformity so that what we do and how we walk is how Jesus would walk, Lord. And that a monumental, impossible task is still with the promise of forgiveness, that when we sin, that you are there to offer forgiveness for our confession, Lord. But Father, help us this morning to understand this commandment that you've given to us, to wrestle with the fact that it is old and new, but then to see how it helps power us to be in the light, to walk in Christ, to walk in your holiness and your truth. And all this to be done for your glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You may be seated. So I love the fact that John, in his infinite wisdom, okay, his wisdom isn't infinite, but in his great wisdom, he's probably in his 80s at this point, much life behind him, begins by telling us that this commandment he's giving us is both old and new. And it's not really old and it's not really new, but it's old and it's new. It's like, okay, John, which one is it? Is this thing old or is it new? Am I buying a car that the odometer's been rolled back on and you're promising it's new, or is there some mileage on this thing? And so he's giving us, really letting us know that the command to love, which we'll get into the fact of identifying what the command is as old as the word itself, as old as the Bible itself, and quite honestly, as old as time itself. So it's an interesting paradox we find ourselves in right from the very beginning. So in verse 7, he says, Beloved, I'm writing to you no new commandment, but an old commandment that you've had from the beginning. The old commandment is the word that you have heard. So he's letting us know, first of all, that this thing is not new, it's old. And then in 8, he says, At the same time, it is new. It is a new commandment that I am writing to you, which is true in him, in Jesus, and in you, because the darkness is passing away and the true light is already shining. So we have to think about this for a second. What is the commandment? So before we get arguing over, is there a new sign on this thing or is there a used sign on this thing? What is the commandment that he's getting to? And I think if we turn to John 13, we start to get an idea of what this commandment is. Don't have to turn there if you don't want to, but John 13, 34 gives us a little hint into what he is getting at. And this is John recording the words of Jesus, and he says in verse 34, of John 13. A new commandment I give to you, that you love one another, just as I have loved you. You also are to love one another. So it's a new commandment. And of course, we're sticking with John there, so we understand that that's John's understanding of the new. But then how is it old? So if you want to bring up the next slide, go ahead and click it one more time. So what is the commandment? So we see that the commandment's listed in 1 John 2:10, but also we know that the command to love is as old as he tells us, as the word itself. So if we go to Leviticus, should have put bookmarks in here. So in Leviticus, chapter 19, verse 18, it says, "You shall not take vengeance or bear a grudge against the sons of your people, but you shall love your neighbor as yourself. I am the Lord." So that's probably where we get the fact that this is an old commandment. This command to love is an old commandment. It's a commandment that we should love our neighbor as we already love ourselves. So there's already an understanding that we love ourselves. Anyone here not love yourself? You probably brushed your teeth this morning, you showered, maybe you fed yourself. There's a lot of love for ourselves, and quite honestly, sometimes that can devolve into pride. And I think at some level, almost all sin can even be taken back to pride, because we love ourselves so much that I'm willing to do maybe some things that aren't right and are against God's will because I've defined how happiness is. My happiness. Now I'm prideful because I'm making these decisions for myself. But John here is trying to say that, boy, if you already love your neighbor as you, I guess not John, but in Leviticus 19:18, Moses here is telling us that if you already love yourself, boy, if you love your neighbor as you already love yourself, how would that love look? It's a challenging question because we love ourselves. What are some of the basic things we do? We feed ourselves. Well, aren't there commands in the Bible to feed those that are hungry? We shelter ourselves. We give shelter to those that that do not have shelter. To look out for the widow, the orphan, to give shelter and love and support. So how much better would this world look if we just followed this very basic but complex, and if we're honest with ourselves, a difficult command to follow? Boy, I have to love Tom as I already love myself? I know, that's a really bad example. That's even harder to imagine, isn't it? But isn't that, it's amazing to think that our neighbor, and then that we know, those of us in this room, right? We're familiar, so it's almost easier for us to reach out and help a friend, to pray for Dixie for her eye surgery, or to pray for Tiffany and her conversations with her friend who's a lifer. That's almost easy. But how much harder is it to maybe extend the definition of a neighbor to other people in our community? Maybe the ones that we don't know their name, and to love them as we already love ourselves. It's challenging, we have to admit, right? It's a challenging thing to even consider. So when we think about what this commandment is, it's starting to become clear that this love commandment is to love our neighbor as we already love ourselves. And then Jesus kind of identifies what it is in John 13, 34, when he says it's a new commandment, but it has its roots in the old commandment. So we have this expectation that it's an old commandment, and then John is letting us know that it's old and new. He actually even also says in the second letter that he wrote to these churches in 2 John, verse 5, he says, "And now I ask you, dear lady, not as though I were writing you a new commandment, but the one that we've had from the beginning, that we love one another." So there's really a strong call to love one another. And we'll get in a little bit to an understanding of what that love really looks like, because that's critical for us to understand. Because like we talked about last week, is it loving for me to let my child just walk out to a busy road and not yell at them or pull them back or physically intervene? That's not loving. So sometimes a harsh intervention is the most loving thing that could be done. So we have to kind of wrap our minds around what love is really understanding, what love really entails here. So basically what we're looking at is now we see how John can call this commandment old. And we see that John is adamant that this is not a new commandment, rather an old commandment. But now we want to look at why is this commandment new? And if you want to click to the very next one, I'm sorry, I'm getting a little ahead of that. But how is it new? So we have to understand how is this new, and I think, and I read John Piper, he kind of helped me with this particular verse in one of his writings. He said that if we read this verse backwards, verse 8, I'm sorry, I want to say this verse backwards, it will actually help us understand what he's getting at. Now, if you try to do that word for word, it won't make any sense. What he's saying when we read it backwards, kind of read it backwards with phrase for phrase or thought for thought, and it may help us understand the newness of this. And the way he paraphrased it backwards is, let me read it forwards first. Verse 8 says, the way John wrote it, at the same time, it is a new commandment that I'm writing to you, which is true in him and in you, because the darkness is passing away and the true light is already shining. John Piper suggests that for our modern Western minds to maybe understand John's logic here, he would suggest this reading. Since the light is already shining and the darkness is passing away, the result is that the love commandment has come true in Christ and is coming true in you. It's an interesting thought. Piper argues that the key to understanding this verse in this way is the word already. The light is already shining. When this command came in Leviticus 19, the light wasn't shining yet. Jesus has come, and now the light is already shining. So if we think about a sunset, that kind of gives us an idea. You start to see the light crest before the sun actually comes over the horizon. And I have a short video which will maybe help us understand that and give it, in new ways, it'll give it a picture to what maybe this already shining and this newness means. Does that make sense? Doesn't that help you guys? I threw this on Paul, I think, during the prayers. To be able to see it, the light was already shining. In fact, the sky was practically lit up and the sun was not yet over the horizon. So in that way, this command to love is new, and because it's Jesus has fulfilled this love command, and that, as this text tells us, that it's new because now we're standing in the light, we're loving, the command can be fulfilled in us through Jesus Christ. That light that is breaking over the horizon, that delineates land from sky, that beam of light that's coming up over that horizon is Jesus Christ. And as we're commanded, because God is light, as we're commanded to walk in that light, we're reflecting that light, the love that Christ has, that God has for this world. And we do that when we walk in the light. So there's that newness kind of explained for us. There's another verse here, and it's from Isaiah 60, verses 19 through 20, when we think about Jesus or God as the light. In Isaiah 60, Isaiah is really talking about the glory of the new Jerusalem to come. So that day when all things are made new. And he says in verse 19 of Isaiah 60, "The sun shall be no more your light by day, nor for brightness shall the moon give you light. But the Lord will be your everlasting light, will be your everlasting light, and your God will be your glory. Your sun shall no more go down, nor your moon withdraw itself, for the Lord will be your everlasting light, and your days of mourning shall be ended." Hallelujah, huh? But if we read this, we are understanding that no longer will we rely on the sun for light. No longer will the moon reflect the sun's glory. That in the newness of life, when the heaven, new heavens and new earth are actually here, that we'll be standing in light that is from God. And that newness is the fact that Jesus is already shining, that already not yet perspective. When that time-lapse video of the sunrise was showing us is that light shines even before we see the sun. And here in this verse, John is saying that the shining, that beam of light that brings light to darkness, a very strong theme here, is Jesus Christ. John Piper goes on to say, the shining is seen in love, a commandment fulfilled in Jesus and being fulfilled in us. And it's that already, not yet, perspective or tension that we live in. That Jesus' kingdom is as sure as established, but is still growing, because we're not yet fully there yet. God hasn't come to put all evil and all sin, death, Satan, into the lake of fire. So we stand in that tension of the light is shining, not yet here. And there's newness in that. So as we walk in the light, as we abide in Jesus Christ, we're actually standing in that beam, and that we are commanded to do that. That's also why I asked Tom to read that familiar section from John 3, because it informs us that Jesus is the light. He's the light that exposes darkness. The two cannot coexist. Yes, there's sunrise and sunset, but the darkness always gives way to the light. And when we walk in the conformity to his will for our lives, we are doing what is true, and the exposure of light shows everyone that it is not for us that we are doing these things, but for God. As Tom read, in fact, in John 3, 20 and 21, it states, for everyone who does wicked things hates the light and does not come to the light, lest his works be exposed. We ever get the idea that my sin is hidden? We're getting away with that? That conscious sin that we persist in? And we're afraid for that to come out into the light, because it'll be exposed. Embarrassment? Maybe humility, maybe the humbling that we might need. And we should fight that tendency, especially as Christians, because we still stand on 1 John 1, verse 9, where he says, if we confess our sins, he's faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Verse 21, I interrupted my own reading there, but of John 3, but whoever does what is true comes to the light so that it may be clearly seen that his works have been carried out in their own power and glory. No, for God. They've been carried out in God. It's not us that are acting this way, that are calling for to be walking in the light, but God. And when we are walking in God, aren't you a little bit less afraid if the light shines on it? So that we are then a witness to God's saving power, witness to the forgiveness that we've received, the mercy that we've received. So it is because Jesus Christ is already shining that we see that this old commandment is made new. It's given a fresh perspective. I would argue that the newness of this command comes as we walk in the light. And as is true of all forms of legalism, we can begrudgingly follow rules, right? Don't go to movies. Well, there's some probably we shouldn't. Don't go to a restaurant that serves alcohol. Well, maybe there's times where that would be inappropriate. But if we begrudgingly follow rules just because they're following rules, that's not really loving, is it? I'll use an example from my family. Like if one of my kids was picking on the other one, and then we will do the right parenting thing and force an apology. It's like begrudging legalism. And what does one of my children say to the other? Sorry. Roll of the eyes, which then, you know, makes my blood pressure go down when I see eyes roll. But that's not love, is it? Aren't they just doing what I've told them to do, which is okay in some regards, especially when I say get out of the road or that stove is hot, keep your hand down. But what I pray for, that when cooler has prevailed theirs and mine, that maybe they'll think, wow, you know, I really hurt him or her. And then I'm still waiting for the day when this happens. Then they go back and they say, you know what, I am really sorry. I'm sorry I sinned against you. I'm sorry I hurt you. You know what, I'm going to try not to do that again. You see the difference between begrudgingly following legalism versus lovingly following the commands? And we see from our own kids that that doesn't happen automatically, does it? I mean, I'm hoping it will kick in maybe if they're like me in their 30s. But, so we got to get that picture of that begrudging sorry versus wanting to truly be repentant to them. And there's one more point that needs to be made from verse 8, and that is that darkness is passing away. Notice that it doesn't say will pass away when we read there in verse 8. Rather, it says it is passing away. I mean, the timing on that thing. But darkness is passing away. And I think that as Christians, especially as we have times in our country's life, like Friday, we don't say darkness is winning, we say darkness is passing away. This is just another amplification or showing of darkness, but darkness is passing away. When our Supreme Court enacts laws that give license to sin, effectually institutionalizing sin as they did in the 70s with Roe versus Wade, we don't bury our heads in the sand and disengage with our society. The last thing we should do right now is become a holy hub. Because we need to be out there, we need to be in the world, but not of the world, is our command. And we already know the end of the story, that all evil, all sin, death, and Satan will be tossed into the lake of fire, and that includes Supreme Court-endorsed sin. And rather than wag our fingers at the offenders, lest we forget the plank in our own eyes, we unashamedly preach repentance from sin and forgiveness offered by the precious blood of Jesus Christ. We are far more interested in souls being saved from eternal conscious torment than with people being happy in the vaporous life here and now. And there shouldn't be a person in this church this morning that hasn't won a victory over sin that they once considered brought them happiness. If you're saved by God, you can probably at this moment think back to a sin that at one point you thought, this is good and right, and boy, this makes me happy. I'm going to keep doing this. Because the lie was louder than the truth in our ears, right? But then now we can stand and look back in that sin and say, praise God, glory to God for that not being a part of my life now, that now I see the lie that was wrapped right around that sin. Now I see the truth because I'm walking more in the light, getting a little bit farther away from that shadow of darkness, a little bit more in the light. Now I'm looking back into the darkness and seeing that sin and going, thank you, Lord. I'm so glad the Holy Spirit convicted me of that sin. So we're charged with being, like we talked about this morning already, the prophetic voice of God for our world in all places and all times. And it just so happens in our place and time, sexual desires rule the day. But it also just so happens that our Bible has a lot to say about that. It offers forgiveness. It offers guidelines. It offers support in the church. It offers changed lives. And it offers being born again and not settling for being born that way. Because every single one of us has been born that way with a pre-inclination to sin. And we still fight with it in our lives. Hopefully less so, but every time one goes away that we have conquered through the power of the Holy Spirit, there's another one coming. So it kind of keeps us from putting ourselves up on a pedestal and keeping God there. So we see then that from this verse that darkness is so defeated that it is already passing away. Jesus is already reigning. His kingdom is growing every day, and his love and his light are shining even today. And since John had pressed his readers to ethical and moral standards, remember, God is light, he gives three whoever tests to close out this section. And we read, beginning in verse 9 of 1 John 2, whoever says he is in the light and hates his brother is still in darkness. Whoever loves his brother abides in the light, and in him there is no cause for stumbling. But whoever hates his brother is in the darkness and walks in the darkness and does not know where he's going because the darkness has blinded his eyes. The first test is verse 9, and it calls out those who are making the claim of being in the light, or more specifically, claiming to be Christians. And we're going to hear a lot of Christians claim in the coming days, weeks, and months that they're in the light, but then giving license to unrepentant, sinful lifestyles. That is not loving. And this verse tells us that they actually hate their brother. Because they're willing to say, be happy, as that leads them to a life, eternal life in hell. If they're unrepentant of that sin. They're not battling with that sin, because we all do. The truth, that truth cannot be lost on us this day. It is not loving to lead someone to unrighteousness, to endorse and license an unrepentant, sinful lifestyle that if left unforgiven, unrepented of, earns hell. That is actually hating our neighbors, and as John would say, abiding in darkness. And in verse 11, John says that the one who hates his brother is in the darkness and walks in the darkness and does not know where he's going because the darkness has blinded his eyes. Speaking of spiritual eyes here, of course, but this is literally the spiritually blind leading the blind. I'm walking, I have no clue where I'm going. Follow me. It's a scary proposition. Mostly because we all can probably think back to our lives and see where we were also blinded and walking in sinful lifestyles. Their eyes have become so accustomed to spiritual darkness that they are comfortable in their darkness. They do not even know where they're headed. But sandwiched between those two dark verses is the light that is already shining in verse 10, which states, whoever loves his brother abides in the light, and in him there is no cause for stumbling. Obviously, these verses were heavy on my mind this week. And I thought about some of the pastors that I saw on Twitter and Instagram. And I just pray that they too would walk in the light and repent for their sins. Because if I got everything I wanted in my life that made me happy that I thought, I would be probably one of the most sinful people around. My sin is not to be endorsed, it's to be called on and called for repentance. And a repentance that's possible because God promised it. That if you're faithful, if you confess, he's faithful and just, right? To forgive. We're not asking anyone to do something that's impossible. We're asking for repentance. Lord, I pray that their repentance happens and that the scales, the spiritual scales, fall from their eyes. So as we close this morning, let us as Christians remember that this is a commandment. Keep in mind, he doesn't say at the beginning, I suggest to you, this might be a good idea. This is truly a commandment. We are commanded to love our brothers and sisters. I would argue both those in the Lord is more than likely this text is leading us to know, but as we think about the entire canon of Scripture, to love our neighbors as well. We must be reminded that this command is both old in that it is rooted in the Old Testament, and that it is new in that new love is now available in Jesus Christ. And that as we love, we need to check our hearts for hate and make sure we're lovingly leading our brothers and sisters, our neighbors, in the way of the Lord, not the way of the world. We would hate for someone to go happily to hell when in Jesus Christ they can be ushered lovingly into new life now and for eternity. So help, my prayer is that this section of Scripture helps us to see not only this issue that's hot and heavy right now, but how all of our lives can be changed as we walk in the light. There's real moral and ethical claims and commands that John is giving us here. And it's all encompassed by love. So that as we think about God's commandments, he's not keeping us from happiness. He's actually calling us to joy. What a loving thing that is. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you that your commands that are both old and new ring true for us, Lord. Lord, I repent this morning that it took a decision like the Supreme Court on Friday for me to consider the newness of the love that you're calling us. That I don't consider my everyday to be important, to be walking in the light. So Father, help me to walk more in the light and to always be on guard for witness opportunities, to share your truth and your love and your forgiveness and your changed lives, your being born again. Help that to be on the forefront of my mind as I go through my day, not something that I feel like I have to begrudgingly do. Lord, also help me and our church to be ready for the refugees of this latest movement that will leave many hurt in its wake. Father, I ask that the blindness that is on many eyes this day and for all eternity, but I ask this day, Lord, that many would be called to the light and that their scales would fall off their eyes and that they would, under the Holy Spirit's conviction, recognize their sin. And again, under the gift of you, offer repentance. Confess that sin, turn from that sin, and turn to you, Lord. Maybe even for the first time. Father, help us to be the salt and the light as we are interacting with our world, because I know that on Monday, discussions will happen in the workplace. Help us to handle them lovingly, but never, ever wavering on the firm commands and call of your word, especially in the gospel. Our battleground is the gospel. Help us to ring true and ring loudly that bell today. Help us to be your salt and light. Help us where we fail, where we fall short, inevitably and always. It's in Christ's precious and matchless and holy name we pray. Amen.